Yes.
¿Cómo le va? Soy Charlie López. Bienvenido a otro capítulo de Yes, la nueva forma de acercarse al inglés. Y de entrada, ahí nomás, lo desafío. Vamos a ver si se anima a poner en pasado todos los verbos resaltados que va a ver en pantalla. The movies.
Dinosaurs, and I got in a fight with Billy Makowski.
What happened?
He hit me.
Did you hit him back? Why'd he hit you?
He said my dad ran off because he didn't like me. I learned about dinosaurs, and I got in a fight with Billy Makowski.
What happened?
He hit me.
Did you hit him back? Why'd he hit you?
He said my dad ran off because he didn't like me.
Yo ahora le voy a pedir que complete las expresiones idiomáticas que va a ver en pantalla y de paso, prueba su inglés. Test your English. Bueno, vamos a completar entonces las expresiones idiomáticas con números. A ver, is company. No le digo nada. Vaya pensando. You are the, con números. Otra más. Dressed up to the. Qué difícil que viene hoy. He drives a. By. Y queda una más. We have been at. And this week. Uy, una más todavía. Give me, shouted Alan after the goal. Vamos con la primera. Three is company. Claro que sí, nosotros le decimos tres son multitud. You are the one. Hay una canción, Robbie Williams la conoce. El hombre ideal, en este caso. Dressed up to the nines. Vestirse con su mejor ropa, de punta en blanco. He drives a 4x4, una 4x4. We have been at sixes and sevens this week. Significa con problemas, desorganizados. Give me five, shouted Alan after the goal. Choca los cinco. Segunda parte. My boyfriend is charming and urban or urbane. Uy, ¿cuál será la correcta? Bueno, la correcta es la segunda, urbane. Esta palabra identifica a alguien que sabe cómo comportarse socialmente, que tiene confianza en sí mismo y se aplica generalmente a la conducta del hombre. ¿Y qué significa urban? Bueno, eso es urbano, relacionado con pueblos y ciudades. There is unemployment in urban areas. Yo te lo conté la semana pasada. Hay palabras de la lengua inglesa que se nos infiltraron, algunas hace muchísimos años. Son palabras que no son de aquí, son de allá. Por eso yo las llamo outsiders. Bueno, como todas las de outsiders, son palabras que se nos infiltraron en el castellano. Comienza con H y esta es la pista. Quien obtiene o altera información dentro de otros sistemas informáticos. 5 seconds. Hacker. Segunda posibilidad. Dispositivo que protege al conductor de un vehículo en caso de accidente. Comienza con A. 5 seconds. Airbag. Tres significados de un mismo término. Y vos me decís cuál es la palabra. Say the word. Bueno, ahí va el primero de los tres significados. Top part of body. Y una oración, a ver, shake your, vaya pensando el término. Mind, that's the second meaning. Think, use your, ¿cuál será la palabra? Person in charge. A ver, un ejemplo. He's the of the family. Say the word. The word is head.
Yes.
Cuando alguien alcanza un objetivo with flying colors, lo hace con éxito incuestionable, con honores. Esta expresión data del siglo XVIII, cuando las naves de guerra desplegaban sus banderas al regresar a puerto para indicar que habían ganado la batalla. Un ejemplo, the students passed the test with flying colors. Más diferencias entre el inglés británico y americano. ¿Y dónde aparecen? En British and American English. Usted está buscando el baño en Inglaterra. Pregunte por el toilet. En Estados Unidos diga bathroom o restroom. Linterna, torch, flashlight, refugio de peatones, los que están en medio de las calles, de los caminos, traffic island o safety island en Estados Unidos. ¿Y el semáforo? Traffic lights para los ingleses, stop light en inglés americano. ¿Cómo compra zapatillas? ¿Qué dice trainer o trainers, si es plural, y sneakers en los Estados Unidos?
Yes.
Atención. Hello, little Ann. How nice. Really, how nice. Little Ann, chicos, me dice que por primera vez probó el azúcar negra y le encantó. Pero bueno, además le pedí que se quede para corregir los errores que van a aparecer en pantalla. Spot the mistake. Uy, qué lindo, ahí viene la hormiga, vamos a ver qué nos trae hoy. A ver, Just Mary is my friend. Es demasiado. Mírale los ojos, está furiosa. Bueno, igual que tu maestra cuando vos te equivocás. Claro, no podés ponerle does, porque is es parte del verbo to be. Cuando está el to be o cuando está is, am, are, no pones ni do, ni does, ni nada. Simplemente lo invertís. En vez de decir Mary is, decís is Mary. Y es lo que hizo la hormiga. Ahí trae otra. Ya me da un poco de miedo, debo confesar. Does your brother speaks English? ¿Estará bien? ¿Vos qué pensás? No, no, mirá la cara. No. Ahí va la regla. Me comió la S. Por supuesto, porque cuando está el does al verbo, se le quita la S. Y ahí me trae una más. Why did you broke my toy? A ver. Más furiosa que antes. Ya, algo dijo. Algo dijo. Escúchala. Bien, es el mismo error y vos ya lo detectaste. Si pones el did, no me pongas el verbo en pasado. Ponelo en infinitivo. Did you break? Yo sé que usted está de acuerdo, por eso lo hago. Sigo armando una lista de palabras que usted siempre quiso saber en inglés. Look it up. Bueno, aquí venimos con cinco palabras que usted siempre quiso saber. Minuta, ¿cómo se dirá minuta? Sí, sí, me refiero al restaurante, esa comida que sale rápido. Moflete. Mordisquear. Mugre. Muñequera. Vamos con minuta. Quick meal. Facilísima. Moflete. Chubby cheek. como si fuera mejilla gordita. Mordisquear, to nibble. Mugre, suciedad, se dice filth. Y a la muñequera, wristband, en inglés.
Bueno, creo que usted ya sabe. Yo tengo un amigo que se llama Pepe Bondi, a quien estoy dando clases para que viaje al exterior. Y bueno, eso lo hacemos en Let's Travel.
Bueno, Pepe, hoy tenemos que imaginar que estás en un buen hotel y querés comer en la habitación. ¿Cómo pedís un sándwich?
A kill hunger sandwich, please.
No, Pepe, el matambre. No es un fiambre común en otros países. Yo sugiero que pidas un club sandwich, que es un sándwich internacional. Y lo pedís a tu habitación. A ver.
Club sandwich, room 221, quickly.
Ok, te van a entender, pero no es muy educado, es demasiado imperativo. Tendrías que decir algo así como, I'd like to order a club sandwich for room 221, please. A ver, Pepe.
I'd like to order a club sandwich for room 221, please.
Excelente, Pepe. Ahora ya podemos viajar. Let's travel.
Hay varios first certificates, no sé si lo sabías. La pregunta es, ¿cuáles son? ¿Quién los puede rendir? Bueno, hace unos años entrevisté al director de evaluaciones de la Universidad de Cambridge y esto es lo que me dijo.
Nigel, welcome back.
Thank you.
Here we are for the second part of the interview. And I will tell you this. As a teacher, an old teacher, it has always been a mystery for me the way international exams, particularly the first certificate. You remember when the first certificate was called Lower Cambridge?
I do.
Oh,
yes,
that means we are very old.
When I was a teacher, when I was teaching students.
Yeah, when you were teaching Lower Cambridge.
Yeah.
And then the question is, it was always a mystery for me and for many teachers. What we have to know to pass, or if you need 20%, 40%, 80%, if there is an average of papers, you can fail one and pass the others. So this is the moment when we have the right person to tell us a little bit about this.
Okay, so there were many questions in there, but let's take them one at a time. So certainly, yes, you don't have to pass every single paper.
Uh-huh.
So each paper doesn't actually have a pass mark. You get an overall score, so it's a holistic look at your English language ability. So you can be maybe not quite as good at listening, but better at speaking, and still pass overall. So that's one thing. In terms of what you need to know, I think that's been defined much better since the days of Lower, for example. For the last 20 years, there have been the European Commission have produced material around the Common European Framework, which actually defines what you need to know at each level and first certificate advantage level of the Common European Framework. In terms of how examinations are marked and what mark you need to pass, it's in general around 60% of marks. This may go very slightly up or down depending on the difficulty level of the test, but it's more or less 60% to get a pass at first certificate at B2 level.
And to get a B, for example, you need some 70%?
To get a B is ordinarily around 75% of marks.
And for an A?
And for an A, it's around about 80, but over 80.
From 80 to 100, which 100 must be really difficult.
Yeah. It's very difficult to get,
even
yes.
For natives?
No, it would be because, of course, in an exam situation, everybody makes a slip or
absolutely,
makes a mistake.
Performance mistakes and things like this.
Yeah.
Second difficult question. If a student, suppose, because of different reasons, does not speak at all in the oral exam, but is excellent in all the others, he will still pass? Because, you know, in the oral part...
It's possible they would still pass. If a person really freezes and doesn't say a word in English and gets zero for speaking, it's then going to be very difficult to pass overall.
Yeah.
But if you were to get full marks in all the other test, then you probably would still pass. Can I say this is a profile of, I don't think I've ever seen
in terms of a candidate's
result. Things aren't that extreme.
So what you understand or assume is that there is some kind of communication between the papers. If you are so good writing and listening, you are supposed to be able to speak fairly well.
Yes, that's right. So some of the papers, you tend to see performance that's quite similar. So if somebody's good at speaking, they tend to be good at listening as well. If somebody's good at use of English, they'll tend to be good at writing as well. But you can see what we call a jagged profile across the skills sometimes.
But some people say that those good at receptive skills sometimes are not good when they have to produce.
Yeah, that can happen as well.
That can happen, yeah.
And you do see changes with different cultures. For example, people in the Far East are often better receptively than in terms of the productive skills.
And do you consider that when preparing the exams? I mean, a first certificate that's different for Japanese students than for Argentinians?
No, it's exactly the same. It's exactly the same test material. We make sure that our tests are truly international, so there's nothing in our test that will give a bias against any language group or culture. And we use pre-testing and statistical analysis to make sure there's no bias in the material that we produce.
What happens with exams like the CPE, the Certificate of Proficiency in English, which, if I'm not wrong, when I was a teenager, last century, was the star of the exams, because it was the first exam. If I'm not wrong,
right, in 1913.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, then came the law of Cambridge
that's
and all.
Right.
And today, at least in our classes, language schools, etc., has practically disappeared.
Really?
Yeah, because you don't get students to study so hard to reach that level. What do you think about that?
I think it probably differs country to country. I don't know the situation here in Argentina because this is my first visit to Argentina. I'm very happy to be here. But I would say it probably differs country to country because worldwide, the number of students taking proficiency is the same.
It's the same.
I think one reason that maybe numbers of proficiency candidates hasn't increased is because advance has become more important.
That's what happened.
So, for example, for university entrance in the UK, or also in many universities in the States, advanced is sufficient at C1 level to show that your English is good enough to be able to study at a
university. Well, that's probably one of the main reasons here.
In other countries, proficiency has a lot of currency. It can really get you places. So, for example, in some countries, if you pass proficiency, it qualifies you as an English language teacher, for example. Mm-hmm. So in some countries, it's a really important qualification still.
Last question today.
Okay.
Is it true, perhaps I'm wrong, I don't know, you say, that there are places where metal detectors are used for students not to get into the exam classroom with the gadgets that help them?
Yes. As an examination board, we have to treat security really, really as a major importance. We have to make sure that the integrity of our examinations is upheld. We have to be really careful to make sure that people aren't cheating in examinations. For some examinations, some of the very high-profile exams, we do actually sometimes use metal detectors to make sure that people aren't taking things into the examination.
That are, in a way, telling them what to write.
Yeah. It's something we're continually having to monitor and be aware of.
It's the only
way. Because we have to stay... We hope to be one step ahead.
Ahead, it's difficult with teenagers today.
It is difficult. And there's always new things coming onto the market, like pens that can scan question papers and things like that. So we have to be very aware of all these things. We make sure that all our supervisors and invigilators who monitor people taking the exam, that they're aware of all the different ways that people can
use the cheat.
Nigel,
thank you very much for this interview.
It's been a pleasure, Charlie.
For me too.
Thank you.
Bueno, usted lo escuchó. Director de Evaluación de los Exámenes Internacionales de la Universidad de Cambridge.
Yes.
Y llegaron los libros. A ver. ¿Cuál es este? Se llama Get Ready for Flyers.
Este libro aporta una preparación integral y motivante para chicos que preparan el curso Flyers. Complementa el libro de texto con actividades que refuerzan gramática y vocabulario. Muchas gracias a la gente de Oxford University Press. Open Skies, un curso para jóvenes adultos en inglés americano. Está compuesto de 6 módulos con explicaciones gramaticales claras y gran variedad de ejercicios. Es de MM y lo envía Study Libro. ¿Lo conoce? Ahí está. Go with Go Getter. Everyone gets more. Un libro para jóvenes adolescentes que alienta la adquisición del idioma a través de animaciones gramaticales, materiales multimediáticos y videos de la BBC de Londres. Gracias, Pearson. Ah, tengo 2 más. Ahí está. Mire este. Academy Stars. Este es el nivel 4 de Academy Stars. Este curso viene en 6 niveles. Trabaja las 4 habilidades e incorpora un novedoso Graphic Grammar Focus con animaciones que fijan de manera agradable los temas aprendidos. Gracias, Macmillan. Y me voy. No se pierda este libro. Ahí está, Sing Me a Song. Este es un libro con más de 50 canciones tradicionales en inglés. Y son canciones realmente para disfrutar en casa y en el aula. Y viene con CD y lo envía Edelvives. Y bueno, ahora sí, llegó el momento de despedirnos hasta la semana que viene. Esto fue Yes, la nueva forma de acercarse al inglés.